Well, good morning, church. So happy to see you in the house today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Corinne. I'm the pastor of Worship Arts here. And actually, Pastor Robin and I, just a week ago, were down in Whistler together with our spouses at a BCMB, that's our denominational covering, at a retreat. And so it was really great to just be away and be refreshed and meet some people. It was really funny because I feel like every person that I met had a connection to Prince George, but not all from Westwood, surprisingly. Some of them were just really random, and I knew most of them. So I wasn't expecting that, but it's a small town, small world. I say that for one reason, the fact that I was down there, for one reason. Something really fun was that a lot of the sessions that we were at during this retreat included some games. And how many of you know, like, youth group style or camp style games? They're just a lot of fun. They were run by, these games were run by a couple of youth pastors, so they were just awesome. They were so good. I'm going to share one with you in a minute, but before I do that, just a heads up, we have a celebrity in the house today. Where's Dave Horton? Where are you? He's not in the room, I don't think. You think he's out there. Anyways, so we during our teaching time today, we actually have something a little bit different. Dave Horton, there he is. So instead of a traditional sermon teaching time, we actually have Dave Horton sharing with us this morning, so that's going to be awesome. And so I figured, because it's like a camp style thing this morning, and I got humiliated greatly at one of the games at the retreat last week, I thought I'd share one with you. So does anybody want to play a game with me? Say yes, yes, yes. Okay, so this is going to be fun. I want you to guess by the lyrics that I'm going to say. I'm not going to sing them because that'll give it away. I need you guys to guess what song I'm talking about. But I have to wear this. So are you guys ready? You guys can laugh. It's okay. Jesus likes joy. Let's see if I can get it in. Wrong way. Maybe I could do that way. Are you ready? Okay. I'm going to... Okay. Are you ready? Okay, here we go. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose law is mighty and so much stronger? Anybody? Do you know it?
Yes.
Say it out. The King of Glory, the King of all kings. Does anybody know the song? Okay, we're not going to sing that song, but see? Jesus loves joy. That's the whole point of that. So why don't we stand together? Let's give our joy to the Lord. Let's offer our praise to him today.
Lord, you are greatly to be praised, and your faithfulness surrounds you as all of heaven stands amazed, and creation bows before you. Lord, we'll bow before you. There's only one who is worthy, who overcomes, who will never fail. Light of the world, everlasting, Jesus, you are Lord of all. For all your promises.
Trust God that you are with us, and that our lives don't need to seem well for it to be well, because we have you. So God, we sing this together.
Grand earth has quaked before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, my eyes are on. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on, and it is well.
Through it all, my eyes are on. Through it all,
Standing, I'm going to call on Pastor Ryan to lead us through communion.
Good morning. You may be seated. We're going to partake in communion. So if you didn't grab one of these on your way in, please just raise your hand and the ushers would love to give you one. But when we participate in communion, Jesus instructed us that when we do it in remembrance of him. So yes, we remember what he did. We remember his suffering, that he went to the cross and that he died for us, defeating death and allowing us to enter into a right relationship with God and have eternal life with him forever. But when you remember someone, you also remember who they are. And so when I think about that, like when I think about Jesus and who he was and the example he set, I think of things like his sacrificial love, that he was willing to suffer and that he enters in with us when we suffer and walks alongside us. I think of someone who is all powerful, a king in his own right, but chose humility to submit himself to God's will and to serve. I think of someone who had tremendous compassion on people, especially the poor and those who were suffering. And when I think about that and I remember that, it encourages me that if, as a follower of Jesus, I'm to pattern my life in the same way as him. And so this morning, when we remember Jesus, may we remember what he has done for us. But may we also remember who he was. And may we seek to emulate who he was in our own lives, in our own context. So if you would, just open the bottom and let's take the bread together. Remember that the bread represents his body that was broken for us. And let's take the cup together. And as we do, let's remember that the cup represents his blood which was poured out for us. Let's pray together. Jesus, I thank you for what you did for us, that you were willing to suffer and die, that you didn't stay dead, you rose again. Jesus, thank you for conquering death for me and for us. And Jesus, thank you for the incredible example you set for us of someone who lived a life, who exemplified a life of walking with the Spirit and being empowered by him. And I pray for each one of us, God, that you would empower us by that same Holy Spirit to live lives that model Jesus' life in our own life today. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
So I invite you to stand. We'll sing one more song together.
Thank you. church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel to the whole shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, he is freedom, I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
For the work of the cross. We'll never get tired of thanking you for that, God, because it is the foundation of our faith and the way that we can hope and trust in you. So God, we just thank you for that today. And just pray as we continue on in our worship service, God, that you would be honored and lifted up in everything that we say and do. And we pray this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. And good morning to Westwood Church. Welcome here to each one who's here in person and to those who have joined us online. We're so glad you've come to celebrate and to worship with us. I want to invite our ushers forward, and we're going to continue to worship the Lord through the giving of our tithes and our talents and our offerings to the Lord. We're so grateful that you continue to give and support the work and the ministry of Westwood Church, which is so much bigger probably than most of us even realize. And so on behalf of our board of elders, we're grateful that you continue to stand with us. One of those areas that we support significantly in terms of time and talent and treasure is Nestlake Bible Camp, which has been a part of our world here at Westwood for almost probably 60 years. There's probably some here, even today, that would remember the very beginnings of Nestlake Bible Camp. And Westwood has had an amazing partnership together with this camp for 60-ish years. Nestlake Bible Camp is a place, like all camps, Believing Camps is an awesome place where we see many, many people come to faith in Jesus Christ, where we see young people discipled and grow in their leadership skills and their development. And I, walking around Prince George, moving around Prince George, it is almost impossible to not meet someone, to not run into someone who has been impacted by Nestlake Bible Camp and by the gospel. Some of them have walked away from faith. Some of them are finding their way back to faith. But this city has been impacted greatly by the ministry of Nestlake Bible Camp, and we have the opportunity to be a part of that. And many of us here are involved. And so today we are focusing on our support and our ministry to Nestlake Bible Camp. And as Corinne said, we do have a celebrity in the house. I'm just not sure if it's Dave Horton or his wife, Janine, who has to live with Dave Horton. So there you go. We have an applause. So Dave, welcome here. Dave's the executive director, and I've come to know him over the last number of years, and he has a great passion for camp ministry, and we're so glad that you're with us today with your crew.
Yeah, there's a lot of us.
Like how many?
More than five. Less than 10. I feel like if I could do impressions from what I've heard about the church, if I was doing impressions, who am I doing a preaching impression of right now? There it is. And if I was doing another preaching impression, who would this be? Nobody you know, that's for sure. Hi, my name is Dave. And I am the director at Nest Lake Bible Camp. I've been the director there for about the last kind of like 14 months, but I've worked there full-time since 2005, and every summer since 99, which is like, I'm feeling it. I made fatal errors. It's our men's weekend this weekend. It's our men's camp, and I took my twin boys out there, and we have lied to people. We've been like, come to camp for men's camp. It's restful. It'll rebuild into your soul, and my soul feels rebuilt, but my body is destroyed. And we were playing paintball yesterday, and I was shooting, and then I saw some kids and running, and then this morning, I'm like, I have made mistakes. Oh, by the way, honey, the kids haven't gone to bed. Two 11-year-olds haven't gone to bed before midnight for the last two nights. So, sorry. I'm so bad. It's bad. But it is. Brad Schauer and some of the Westwood crew are out there, and they're having a blast. And it's such a gift. And that's the thing of our partnership with Westwood, is there's just not enough time. It's just straight up what it is. We could stand here and talk about as the health of this church has reached and overflowed outside of the walls of this church into the camp over and over and over. And so it's things like, I think now officially all of our board members go to Westwood at this moment, which is that two of them were playing worship this morning. There's been past board members. Tackling Task Tuesdays is a big deal to us. It is a group of retired folks who come out every Tuesday. They hang out. They take on projects. And where did it start from? Well, you guys aren't a responsive crowd. Is this the early? I was at a Presbyterian church yesterday or last week, and they're liturgical. And so I asked them the call and response stuff. They were on. Let me tell you that. They knew what to do. You know who didn't? Me at the end, when there's like a whole series of things you're supposed to do, and I just walked off the stage, and all of a sudden the organ fired up, and I was like, I think that was supposed to be me. Oops. So Tackling Task comes out, and they have made a huge impact on camp over the years. Just one or two Tuesdays a month is what they're doing right now, and they've taken on projects that I've been waiting years and years and years to do. They did the stairs in the dining hall. They might have had asbestos. We don't know, but they're gone now. And they replaced these broken tiles in the basement of the dining hall that have been there for like a decade. 10 years, we've just not had the resources or the manpower to be like, we're going to replace these broken tiles. And they did it. They did it. So it just goes on and on. And there's also a group that is praying and fasting for the camp right now. And what do you think is the most valuable to me of the camp? Tackling Tasks, if they get canceled, that's okay. If our board members all quit, that would be interesting. That would be very interesting. I would like to see how that played out. But that prayer and fasting group, we cannot do it without that prayer and fasting group. And we cannot do our ministry without you as a congregation praying and fasting and considering us in all these things. And so I'm just going to fly through things. I have way too much. And so I'm watching the clock, and Jenny's got a sniper rifle, and it's going to be a good time. Anyway, she gave me the clicker. She's so nervous. She said, we don't usually give the preacher. I don't think it's a preacher. If you have a year of Bible school, you're not a preacher. You're a presenter. Rob's got his doctorate. He can laugh at that. I've got the control. I've got the power, but I'm going to muddle it up, and I know that. So this is my family. We are the Hortons, and that's pretty much all you need to know, I think. That's it. That's good. Here we go. Some of the things that are going on at camp right now. There is a lot of things going on at camp. The Westwood partnership, we got talked a lot about it just before Christmas and around Christmas time. You guys need to know the impact of that. Right now, there are 71 kids from that school just over there who are signed up to camp this summer. Praise be to God. That is 71 individual lives. It's a third of the school, and we know we can do better. And so kind of our position with the school district has changed a bit, and it's good. It's been a great conversation with the school district, but we're just trying to find new ways. So we're sending out some more information to the kids who are already registered and then sending out some stuff through social media this week as well. So be praying for that. You guys raised $43,000 to send kids to camp, those kids to camp, and that was very clearly spoken to them as a school. And it was like, this group of people loves you in that building. Why? Because you're near us, because you have proximity to us. Have you earned it or deserved it? Nope, you didn't do anything. We just love you, and as God loves us and overflows in his love for us, we're gonna pass that on to you. The messaging that you guys have given to that school is massive, massive, and that we're getting the responses from families that are just blown away. And so we've used $25,000, and I would love to use more than the $43,000 you guys raised. That is for sure. Other things that are going on, just kind of funny little stories that happen. We were cleaning out our freezer. It was minus 20 outside, which is a genius time to clean out your freezer. Isn't that great? It's minus 20, so they just pull everything outside, and all the bears are asleep. I thought that was so smart. And they cleared out the freezer, and then I get this message from our food services manager. She says, the freezer has room for that cow, so just go and find that cow. I'm like, I have no idea what she's talking about. I guess the directors previously have found a free cow. And then it gets slaughtered and it gets given. And I'm like, man, I don't have time for this. I don't know when I'm going to do this. And then a week later, I get an email that says, hey, Dave, somebody wants to donate a cow. Just happened. Somebody randomly in the community at that moment, a week after we cleaned out our freezer and made room, was like, hey, I'd like to give a cow. Our food services manager goes, good job, Dave. And I was like, I just was here. Like, that's all I am is here. Last summer, we had as a board and as a camp staff, we just saw that we were dying for summer team. And so we raised how much we were giving to our summer team, still nowhere near what we actually would give if we were McDonald's or anywhere else that actually pays a reasonable wage. And so we added like an extra $30,000 to our bursaries to try to encourage young people to come and work at the camp. And I, in my head, in June, was like, I can find that money. I can do that. How do you think that went? Right? I had no time through the summer. I did not make it a priority. I did not chase it. Gosh darn it. At the end of the summer, we get a check out of nowhere, like flipping nowhere, for $30,000. And you just sit there with this stupid cow in the freezer, with this stupid check from a 15-year-old kid who sent out his support letter asking for prayer. And there's one line at the bottom. If you'd like to consider, man, I am tired. If you'd like to consider supporting the camp or supporting me at the camp, please give. Some guy way out of Prince George, no connection to camp, says, wow, that kid's serving there for 3 or 4 weeks. Here's 30 grand. And it hits right where the need is. Praise be to God, for he is active and alive and at work. And it's just like you sit there as the director and you just feel like the world's dumbest guy. Because you're like, let's make a plan. And then you just sit there and all these amazing things happen. You're like, wow, this is great. I wonder when I'm going to get involved. So we had I had three buses. We needed a school bus. We're running these day camp programs, and they are filling like crazy. People want to send their kids to camp, but they've lost the trust for overnight camping, or kids just don't do overnight camping as much. Culture is shifting. COVID kept kids at home. And so I reached out. I had three amazing plans at the end of September. I am going to find this bus. And I had three amazing plans, and all three fell through. All three crashed. So I got this message. I think it even says November the 7th. We were sitting there. We were busy. And I was like, man, we got to figure out this bus before Christmas. And I get this text. Hey, give me a call when you can. My response, just at a conference. Can I call Thursday? Oh, no biggie. I bought a bus. I bought a bus, and you can have it. That's the way this rolls. That's the way this goes. And you guys are this, but not just to Ness. You guys are this to each other as believers. You guys are this to Youth for Christ and CEF. You guys are this to, what's the one at the university? IVCF. There's so many acronyms. Christians and acronyms. We got to get over this, people. And so it just goes on and on. And so this is it, right? This is what a text meant. This turns into this because this didn't do what he was supposed to do. Praise be to God. It's great. There's also things like this where we've been working on this. And this is a test. If you work for Technical Safety BC, this is a test. These are not paying customers. And so we are getting closer to this being done. And keep praying for there's lots of little details, lots of little things to do to get this finished up and done. There is 10 new summer team members, or 10 new members at the camp right now are coming out of our year as well. This is Transformations. This is our like kind of main guest group or rental group. They come into the camp. They're not a Christian group, but they kind of work with kind of the most traumatized people in the First Nations communities all over Northern BC. They have had 16 week-long events at the camp. It is massive. And the really crazy thing with this is that lots of guest groups come, and they know they're at a Bible camp. They know it, and they will tolerate it. These guys aren't a believing group, but they say, you can pray with us, you can connect with us, do your meals with us, you can give us scripture as an encouragement, and we've been able to kind of earn the trust with this group where they give us 20 minutes every time to stand in front of them and to say, what happened to your, oh gosh darn it, there it goes again, what happened to your communities was wrong. And we get to say, to come to a Bible camp is unbelievable, that you are willing to come here and to work on yourself and to work on this. I'm not going to read this, but you can read this and ignore me for a sec. And we get to hold a Bible and to say, the heart of Christ breaks for what happened to you and for the trauma that you had to endure, because people holding a Bible did a lot of damage. And that's our main guest group. Where did they come from? Random phone call. Hey, can I rent your camp? It was me who answered the phone. I think so. That's a dumb response, right? That's not good guest services. And so it just goes on and on and on. That's what's going on at camp. And now we're in this thing of prepping. I messed that up, but Jenny's up there looking after me. We are prepping for summer. So I'm going to show you this video. This is from our national One Hope Canada. So we're one of 40 camps across Canada that's owned by One Hope. And this kind of really summarizes a lot.
Let's talk Bible camp.
Yeah, a camp's awesome. Campfires, games, activities, friends, and the food.
Sure, it's all those things, but it's more than that too. It's something bigger, something greater. It's a community that brings God's people together to be on mission to impact the next generation.
On mission?
Uniting around a common purpose. Believers from local churches motivated by the gospel, the good news of Jesus, and their desire to share that good news with others.
Others? Like campers?
Right. At camp, kids come to know who Jesus is, and their lives are transformed. But it's not just the kids, it's adults too. Directors, cabin leaders, lawnmowers, dishwashers, nurses, building fixers, cooks. Their lives are changed because the good news of Jesus becomes more precious to them as they see the power of the gospel at work in the camp setting.
So when we're on a mission together, serving others, something happens in us?
It does. It breathes oxygen on the embers of our faith. Those sparks burst into flame, growing bigger and brighter. It's always been God's plan for the church.
So how does that fit in with what's happening at camp?
Picture this. Fueled by involvement in his local church, a young leader takes his passion for sharing the gospel to camp, maybe as a cabin leader, in the kitchen, or on a work crew. The church enthusiastically gets behind him, sending him with prayer and support, fanning the flame of his passion to burn even brighter. At camp, he shares the light of Jesus with a kid who has never before heard the good news. That kid's life is radically changed. He returns home to get involved in a local church, who embrace him wholeheartedly into their midst, and discipleship continues. On fire for Jesus, his passion influences those around him. What began as a small flame grows brighter, fueled by the opportunity to learn and serve. Eventually, that kid, now a leader himself, returns to camp, where his story inspires the next generation of campers, who return to their local churches to serve. And on it goes.
It's contagious, this on-fire passion for Jesus.
Yeah, when God's people unite around the mission of sharing the gospel, it can't be contained. Their flames burn bright. Their love for Jesus grows along with the desire to share the good news with others.
At camp.
At home.
In their local church.
A growing community bringing God's people together to be on mission.
Everywhere.
And you are a part of those 400 churches. And what a gift you guys have been to us. And so the question is what does Nest Lake do? If you're unfamiliar with Nest Lake, this is us. I'm just going to yabber over top of this video because this shows you what we're about, and I'll quickly tell you what we're about. We are about new experiences. That is kind of like the filter that I think everything at camp runs through, is that we offer new experiences to people at all sorts of different levels, at a social level, with new friends, new caregivers, new ways of interacting, new people in their lives. Emotionally, we offer new experiences, taking new risks, learning to trust, sharing life together with others. You think of that jungle swing? You think that's going to take some people to some new emotional places? I think it's going to take them closer to Jesus. That's what I think. Experiential, there's things like that swing, canoeing and kayaking, archery tag, axe and knife throwing, just mostly for adults, things like that. But the biggest one that we offer new experience for is spiritual, new spiritual experiences that they are not going to have anywhere else, right? Being around those who have been transformed by Christ, having conversations and sharing their personal views. We invite campers to respond to what we present. We say, Jesus is Lord, and they can say, I think that's garbage. And we say, sweet, let's have a conversation. And that's a new experience, a lower pressure environment for that. Learning how to open and understand God's word, that's new. We hand out hundreds and hundreds of Bibles. Hundreds of Bibles into kids' hands and they head home. It's insane that they head home and that these kids have the word of God in their lives. I'll admit we do see a few at Valley Village. We do see a few. What do we see in this video, though? You're mostly seeing campers. And like when you see these faces, know that a lot of these faces are going to be Westwood School kids. Kids that otherwise would not be exposed to the gospel, to the good news of Jesus. And they are going to be here. This is them. You did that. Thank you for being a part of that. The majority of campers that we get are not coming from homes that have any affiliation with church. Our main site holds about 170 kids a week. It has the bigger toys like zip lines and giantness swings and climbing walls and things like that. It's kind of the classic summer experience. You're also seeing summer helpers. There are many of them. You're seeing lifeguards. That guy was not a lifeguard. That is not a lifeguard move. That is not in the NLS standard training. They just hook up the kid in the water and see if they swim. That's what you do. So you're seeing our cabin leaders, video editors, cooks, boat drivers, and we need it. It's bad. It's really hard to find enough people right now. And so if you know those people, bring them to camp. That's for sure. We don't have enough. The difference is since the pandemic, there's a shift and a change, and there's just not enough employees, and we don't have the same incentives to bring people out. We have greater incentives, I think, but it's trying to convince everybody else of that. So if they come as summer team, if you have people, young people, or older people who are looking for that thing to do in the summer, a place to engage, there is some finances. Camp gives a portion. We help them fundraise a portion. And our goal is to get them close to like a reasonable amount to pay for university and college and start to save and those kinds of things. But it does happen together as a partnership with the community and with the camp as well. Anyone can support these summer team. The people doing these jobs on these, if you love what they're doing, I'd encourage you to think about them and to find them in your church and to say, I think you should go to camp this summer. I think you would serve well this summer, and I'm willing to support you financially to do that. That's a big deal, right? That's a really big deal. That's really encouraging for those guys as well. So find them, encourage them. And then skills and experience, it's just massive. What we give folks is big. So you're seeing Wilderness right now. Wilderness is our specialized camp. It's 40 kids a week. There's no roads. There's no electricity. There's no running water. Kids cook their own food. They hike and they backpack out about 12 kilometers out to their own private lake. It is a cool, cool, cool thing for sure. And it's unique because it's very like what camps used to be in the 50s and in the 60s and things like that. So the next thing up on there as well, it says LIT, or Leader in Training Program. And so our Leader in Training Program, we take 20 kids a month, and then we run them through a Leader in Training Program. It was called Work Crew Forever, but Work Crew we found was just essentially, parents always had this thing, why would I pay for my kid to go work at camp? And we're like, because it's going to change their lives. So what we did is change the title of it so it actually reflects what it does. It changes lives. It trains people in leadership. It gives them experience in leadership. So if you know of grade 9 and 10s especially, that's what this is. And it's learning to serve others through hands-on leadership. It's learning leadership is service. You cannot disconnect these two things. And so there's also our year-round events, and we've got things like the Family Work Weekend, the Polar Bear Dip. Rob really should go in. I think Leanne should go in. I think Leanne would raise more money for the Polar Bear Dip than Rob. Amen to that? Amen. It's okay, Leanne. There's only 6 months for them to forget that. The Polar Bear Dip this year raised $30,000. Family Day, we had 850 people show up in 2 hours during a massive snowstorm. That's a lot of people. And we had to turn around another couple hundred. It was insane. Mother-daughter, men's camp, but the next ones coming are like cans for kids. If you've got even your beer bottles, even as good Mennonites, we'll take them. Your cans and bottles, take them to the Nechaco Bottle Depot I think it's May the 27th. But then the Family Work Weekend, your church is plugged into the Family Work Weekend. So Mike Ray, where are you right now? Mike or Richie? Is Mike in here? There he is. They're right beside each other. You want to stand up? These guys are handing out information on it, but essentially it's free. You come to camp, you make camp look better so it looks more like this and less like the dumpster that it looks like right now after every winter. And they're going to be handing out that information, and there's lots of projects, lots of room. You want to just come out for the Saturday? We'll take you. We are happy, and it's kind of family-oriented, but also skill-oriented as well. Also, if you have a 60-foot Zoom boom or a 90-foot Zoom boom, we could really use that. Please bring that. Or if you want to come and scaffold for 3 days, we could really use that. And so camp is wild. Oh, look, that's funny. That's us right now. It's live. It's like Google. And so this is what we do. We give this gift that never quits. But what is that gift? It kind of comes out of this. Nest Lake's mission statement is to glorify God by making Jesus Christ known by word and deed through camping and conference programs. One Hope Canada's vision statement, this is our national for these 40 camps. We present the gospel particularly to those having the least opportunity to hear of Christ, and especially to children and youth. They want us on the hunt for those who are not hearing the word of God. If that makes sense. That's what our national is telling us. And we disciple believers for living and serving through his church. And there's this idea that we should be giving to the church and serving the church and asking the church what it needs and trying to meet those needs as much as we can. And so we do this in this order. We have this, like, it's a flow chart. I love flow charts. And so we made this last year, and this is how we present the gospel. Kids observe us first, and they observe us in our action and in our word. We get the opportunity to present and share our views. After every time that we present and share who we think God is, what we think the truth of the Bible is, there is discussion, so campers get to unpack it. And then from those in those discussions, campers get to hear the testimonies of our young people and of our adults and our speakers. This is what God did in my life. And then from that testimony, there's an invitation. Every kid at camp, so we had 1,800 kids in 2019. We had about 1,000 in 2021. We had 1,300 in 2022. 2023, we already have 1,100-ish kids signed up. And it's May, so that's good news. The bad news is we don't have enough people to be in proximity to those kids to look after them, so that's bad. But every kid gets run through this, and we hit that invitation piece and then that response. Where we're going to focus is on this piece. Well, that is one weak laser, isn't it? You can kind of faintly see it. On the share piece. The share piece is where we're going to focus. Because as we share, we're hearing it more and more and more. We talk with past staff, volunteers, campers. We hear it from the baptismal tanks. And it's this thing of, like, people will have a specific verse stuck in their head from when they leave camp. They leave camp, and there's a specific verse that is stuck in their head. And I'd encourage you right now, do you have a verse that gets stuck in your head? Do you have a memory verse that you did as a kid, or is there a verse that is meaningful to you? Say it to yourself in your head right now. I'd encourage that for sure. And people can't shake it out of their heads. So I'd ask you this. Where's my kids? Are there children there? Run, children, run. Now's your time. Okay, who has a verse that they want to stand up and share? Okay, so you take a bunch. I'm just going to throw it on the floor because I love you. Daddy loves you. Daddy loves you. Okay, so who has a verse that they'd like to stand up and just kind of shout out? Does somebody have a specific verse that they know? Yes, what verse do you have, sir? Gosh darn it, that is like the most beautiful thing. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. How old are you, buddy? Praise be to God that there's an 8-year-old in your congregation who has the hope and a summary of the gospel in his heart. Sermon over. Like, what else do we want? What else do we want to talk about? What else do you want me to convince you of? What else do we need to do? What if we all had that? The One Hope Canada kind of comes, oh, take him candy, take him candy. It was the guy in the green. That's why you're here. Sure, all three of you. That looks great. Not all of it, just like a couple of pieces. We're still a camp. We're still on a tight budget, kids. Think like daddy. Daddy's a cheapskate. One Hope Canada, it's, oh, I'll hit it in a bit. What's another verse? Is there somebody who's got a verse in your head? Challenger, I should put our board members on the spot. That's what I should really do. Oh, Krista, there you are. So no one can boast about the grace that we have received. Isn't that a wild summary? Take your candy. Don't go. I'll do one more. Does somebody else have a verse in your head that you want to say out? Yes. Man alive. What more do we want to talk about? That's three. That's great. Do not fear, for I am with you. Where is God? Where is he? Where is he? Is he with you? That's what it says. Do not fear, for I am with you. Right? This is unbelievable. You guys can go back and have a seat. Good job. Nice job, children. It's unbelievable. I remember as a young guy, I read Galatians 5 for the first time, and I was like, wow, I want this in my head. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. I remember reading that list and I was like, this is the opposite of me and I want this in my life. And if I can get this into my head, maybe God will do some great work and take me away from this thing of not being a source of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. The memorization is big. Memory verses are how One Hope Canada started. The short story is, they told kids in a church, if you memorize 500 verses, not a lot to do in 1930, if you memorize 500 verses, we'll give you a free week of camp. It was fraud. There was no camp. And so kids started to memorize these verses, and then they had to make Gimli Bible Camp. Isn't that hilarious? And then out of that comes One Hope Canada, and out of that comes Nest Lake, and out of that comes the impact on the community. And there again is some guy sitting at his desk going, wow, I should really plan something. And God goes, you know what? We'll just do it all for you. I am ahead of you. I am God. And so it's crazy. It's worth looking up for sure. It's worth going to Gimli Bible Camp's website. They have the story on there. So what have we done? I've picked a few verses that we use as a camp, and we use from our own teaching. But there's a real danger here. Teaching from one verse is wildly dangerous. Right? Proving your point by taking one verse out of Scripture and being like, see, and that's why, blankety, blankety, blank, right? All the things that we could say and abuse one verse for. What I've tried to do is pick a verse that draws in so much of a summary and an overview of God's Word, a consistent themes, and to draw it into this. Because that's often what we're doing with kids. We have these little moments to teach, and we don't have very long. Using one verse to prove anything does not work and is a danger. So my goal here is to encourage you with these five verses that you may forget everything else I say and everything else that we've done today, but that these five stick with you. So our first one is this. So we're going to say it together like we do at camp, like a memory verse game. Ready? So we always start with a thing. You say Matthew 24:35, and then you say the verse, and then you say the verse where it came from again, because that's what we're really all worried about, apparently, is where did that verse come from. So ready? Matthew 24:35. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Oh, too many. Matthew 24:35. Heaven and earth will pass, but my will never. Nice. Matthew 24:35. Heaven and earth will. Oh, yeah, the good ones over there. I messed that up. Good job. Christ's words are more certain. Let me go back here. Christ's words are more certain than the existence of the world. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. This is Christ talking. He's talking about a fig tree. You can look up more. I'll just leave that a cliffhanger. Fig tree? I need to know more. I love figs. No, you don't. No one loves figs. The idea in this is that Christ is saying the universe will pass away. Everything we know, everything we've built, everything you've done with your hands, everything that's been done to you, all the things, the summation of history and creation, all of that will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Well, boy howdy, what does the rest of his words say? If that's what one sentence says, what's the rest of it? Right? Another commentary said, you may sooner expect to see the heavens and earth pass away and return to nothing than my words fail you. That now he's telling us, my words will never fail you. I'm giving you something that will never fail. And it creates this appetite in campers because we're saying to them, you should really know what this says. Because it also says this, Romans 5:8, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. What is the position of God towards us? Is God's position, what is he trying to aim at us? What emotion is he aiming at us? But God showed his great love. Then what happened? Why do I feel pain in my life? Why does it hurt? So you guys are saying you've experienced God's love, and you're saying that God's word never fails and never disappears. So why does it sting? And why does it hurt? Why is there pain in my life? Why do I feel alone? Why do I feel all the awfulness of the world? But then we start to turn minds to say, like, the position of this God is not harm and hurt towards you, but God showed his great love. That is the position of God towards us, is love. God is just. God is righteous. God will judge, and God will hold things to account. But he has chosen to show love, and it's wild. And that's a game changer for kids to hear this. And they're not going to hear this unless we can get them into this proximity to us. Not just camp, but to be thinking bigger. right? Your church, your own ministries that you guys do, InterVarsity, CEF, Youth for Christ, we're out there. We're all working together. We are together doing this. He chose so many, God could have chosen so many ways for us to come to him, but he chooses this, that something has to die for sin, but he does not desire it to be us. He desires to see his son take the punishment for us. This verse reminds us, I read this in a commentary as well, God loves us just the way we are, but too much to leave us the way we are. God loves us just the way we are, but he loves you too much to leave you the way we are. That's exciting, because I don't know what's next in my life, but I'm excited that the one who is able knows. So we'll go to another verse, John 14. Yeah, there we go. John 14, 6. John 14, 6. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I am. These are bold things. Like if I tell these kids, I am the strongest, like I am the smart, I am this, I am the source of hope, I am the source of joy. I will disappoint them on every level of that. But here we are trying to connect campers to this idea of something that will not fail them, because we know failure and we know the sting of failure. From ourselves, from others around us, we know what that feels like. We know what that is. And we're telling them, it's going to keep tasting like that unless we go to this one who says that he is the way and the truth and the life. This is the source. So what is he communicating? His love is great for us. Oh, sorry, I'm on the wrong one. These kids are feeling this. It's framed again in the picture of the good shepherd. A thief comes to take the value out of the sheep, and in that moment to use them for himself. A shepherd comes to grow, guide, correct, heal, protect, and give life. And that tastes different than what they're feeling out there in the world. And this isn't just a length of life, like I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Oh, sweet, because some people are thinking, I don't want to be here forever. Like, this hurts. Existence is pain. Like, this is not a blast. But it's the quality of life that he's offering that is such a gift. Complete, whole, peaceful, beyond all understanding life. To live forever without knowing the fullness of Christ is not a gift. Our testimony enters here. Your testimony enters here. Your story enters here at your workplace, with your families, with your enemies, with your frenemies. Maybe your high drama in your relationships. Can you speak to this life to the full? By a show of hands, who feels like they have been destroyed and have been rebuilt at a moment in their life by the living God? I feel that. Does anyone around you know that? Because that's a crazy thing you just put your hand up for. You feel like you've been destroyed and that a living being, a living God, worked in your life and restored you. That's a crazy thing to raise your hand to. Yeah, I feel like that. Yeah, it's like, who loves chocolate? I like chocolate. I'd probably get less hands on that, which is hilarious. I'd probably get less hands on who loves chocolate than I got on who's tasted the living God and the presence of the living God and the restoration of the living God. That's pretty wild. Also, chocolate ice cream is mediocre. James, not that. That. John 10:10. Oh, I messed all that up, didn't I? Did I? I'm the way, the truth, and life. Yeah, we did that one. Yeah. John 10:10 says this. John 10:10, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. This is what I was talking about with the idea of the sheep. Being a sheep and having a thief look after you, having a shepherd look after you. It's different for sure. We're just going to keep flying through these because there's so many and they're so good. James 1:22. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Oh no, it cut it off again. Do what it says. I swear I fixed that. Do what it says. To hear and to not obey is to be deceived. If you hear it, but you don't obey it, you have been deceived. You have to receive it. You have to receive the word in humility with a teachable spirit and a desire to apply it to your daily life. And that we're reminded of this in Matthew 7. Not everyone who enters the kingdom of heaven, right? Only the one who does the will of my Father. That's the only person who enters the kingdom of the heaven. It's not just knowing it, but it is doing it as well. And it goes on and on and on, and it's exciting. It's so exciting. And there's so many. And this idea of giving the gift that never quits. These five verses have brought me so much hope, and it brings me so much hope in our ministry, knowing that kids are going out with this stuff playing on repeat in their head. And who knows when those are going to come up? In the same way for you, who knows when that's going to come up? I am with you. I am with you is a big thing to come up randomly in your head as you go through hard times. We don't really know how the message goes out, is received. We don't know how it lands, but I want to make this connection. As a camp, what we're trying to do is to constantly look for ways to help kids understand the character and the great love of God by helping them understand and read His Word. That we give them the Word, we help them open it and read it, and then they ship them off, and that they find themselves in the Word, and they find themselves desiring community to understand the Word more. And so the thing is that camp creates proximity to others. Who wants to go for a ride on the jungle swing, right? Who would drive? If I said, we're running the jungle swing for free today, just drive out there, you can go for free. Who's driving out? And this is the thing, is you would drive out for that swing, and then we're going to tell you about the living God. And that's the point of the swing, and that's the point of the fun, and that's the point of the stuff, and that's the point of the toys, and that's the point of the things, is that we are trying to create proximity. We cannot do ministry without proximity. If people are far away from me, I cannot do ministry to them. That is difficult. It is those who are around you. And you're already doing ministry because there's already people around you at your work and in your home and da-da-da, like wherever you are. Let's go back to that frenemies thing. Maybe you really do need to get over yourself and work through this. It's hard to share a verse or encourage them to memorize it when they're not with us. Like I said, we've got around 1,100 campers signed up for camp this summer. That is 1,100 individuals that will all one day be adults and all one day have the memories that they gained from camp with them for the rest of their lives. There's a sense of responsibility that we carry as a camp for that. It's a big deal. We use memory verses hilariously for game points. If your team wins Mission Impossible, you get 8,000 points for your team. If you memorize 8 verses, you get 8,000 points for your team. We have like hyper-weaponized scripture in terms of like, if you want to get big points for your team, memorize the Word of God and tell us. We're doing a thing that's a lot like exploding kittens this summer. Katie was working on it. And it's essentially this, like, kids will tell us a memory verse. We enter them into the random draw. We draw their name out. They get a card, and they can interrupt our program. So we're like, we're going to throw Rob in the lake. And they can be like, nope, no, you're not. You're going to throw this person in the lake. Like, we're giving kids, like, random control. And I don't know how it's going to go, but it sounds awesome because I'm not running program anymore. I'll be in my office. I'll be like, oh, the budget and the bus. And then Dana will be like, ah, my hair. Ah. So it's going to be amazing. But we're always looking for these ways because we're recognizing more and more it's the speaking is good, but just even the memory verses is so much of a goal for us. And so then the question becomes, what would you invest to have that kid that went out that door, who was locked in, embarrassingly enough, what would you give or how would you want to engage? What are you willing to make that happen? And do not just think of Nest Lake on this. Do not simplify it to that. You need to look within your own church and think this. You need to think about IVCF and CEF and the other one that's an acronym and the other one that's an acronym. Because for us, we've got these at our booth. Try to stuff one into your hands. Pray for us. Krista leads us 100 days of prayer, where for 100 days through the summer, we ask for your prayer. You can pick up one of these sheets. Do you want to volunteer? Do you have things that you can do, and a mechanic, an electrician, an arborist, admin help, whatever it is? Do you have an excavator, an RV, a Zoom Boom, a Maniax, Ditch Witch, 60 to 90-foot Zoom Boom that we can move out to camp once the road bans are off in June so we can paint the Founders that hasn't been painted in 20 years and is starting to fall apart? That'd be great. Do you want to support it financially? Great. All these people, all these names that are listed on here, all these folks, yeah, there we go. There we go. All of these folks on there, most of them fundraise their wage. They get paid when they fundraise their wage enough. And there's folks from there's folks that you guys know on here for sure. And I would encourage you to support them. Or don't do it for Ness, because you know who else fundraises their wage? All the folks at Youth for Christ fundraise their wage. And they're doing great work. But it is just encouraging you to know it's happening, and what are we willing to support, and what are we willing to put into it? We need your help. We need your help for sure. Help us build the team. We need help. Invite or volunteer some folks who are finishing grade 10 up to the age of 99 to help us out for a month, for months, for a week, a couple of days, whatever it is. This is a big deal. This is last summer's summer team. Do you remember when I was up here for like a minute and a half, like a couple of minutes, and when I sent out a video in June? We were freaking out, and this is what came in. This is like our Ebenezer. This is what we remember, that the Lord is faithful. We have all these summer team pictures. I've been collecting them since probably like 15 years ago. I was like, I'm going to start to collect these. I think there's a story with these. We've got like 50 of our 70 pictures in the basement, 50 of our 70 photos of our summer teams, because this is a really big deal, because these folks showed up. So I'd encourage you, are you willing to come? You will be able to get that job at Starbucks. It will be available in the fall. It will. They're desperate. So are we. There's a lot of opportunities that you're being told are there. We're asking, are you willing to be a part of this summer team? Or do you know people? Do you have nieces, nephews, siblings, cousins? Who could you invite into this? Because we could use the help, that's for sure. And so there's this research that's been done over the years, and it's the research is that they were doing was like, why are young people walking away from the church? Why are the stats so bad that when people enter university, that they just kind of vaporize from the church? These questions have been asked. These are the studies. Those who attend, this is some of the results that they found, and they found a lot of results from camp. Those who attended religious summer camp as children or youth were over 3 times more likely to remain religious 5 years later than those who did not attend. That's a big deal. The National Study on Youth and Religious Religion was a study of 3,000 teenagers, yada, yada, and they found that 80% of teens who were religious and attended religious camp, when we say religious, for us, that is like connected to the living God through his risen son, Jesus, praise be to God. Anytime I read religion, I'm like, yeah, but that's more. We're still religious 6 years later. Only 56% of those who were religious and did not participate in camp were still religious 6 years or later. Attending a religious summer camp increased the likelihood of remaining religious by 24%. Okay, but what's really funny is we did all this research, but it's almost like we were told this before. Direct your children onto the right path, and when they are older, they will not leave it. All the thousands of dollars and all the people research was done for, and we're brought back to like one proverb that's kind of hard to take out of context. Yeah, what does it really mean, though, to direct your children onto the right path? Like, what is the right path? Whatever. Direct your children onto the right path, and they will not leave it. Why are we doing the research? It's right there. It's been there the whole time. Right? It's a big deal. And so we'd encourage you guys to continue to pray. We're here to say thanks as well. We are here to say thank you for the way that your church has been involved, for the way, oh, that's the end of my show, for the way that you've been involved as a church, for the way that you guys have engaged as a church, for the way that you guys have shepherded your own flock and congregation, for the way that you guys have reached out into the community to grow your congregation and to share God's love. Well, well done. Because we are giving the gift that never quits, God's word. Giving kids in our community the word of God that will never quit working in their hearts and in their minds. It will never stop giving them hope. It will never leave them. Never stops coming to mind when it's needed the most. Never stops reminding them of a God who is pursuing them. So thanks. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And know that we're headed into another summer where I get to just totally fail again. And I get to come back, hopefully sometime next year, and share how God has been faithful despite us. So let's pray. Father, again, we are thankful for today. We're thankful for the opportunities that come with each day to serve you as Lord and King. We just pray that you would remove the entitlement that we have of today, Lord. Help us to receive it as the gift that it is. Help us to also see the good and the bad and to weigh these things and to see past the circumstances and to see that you are good, that you will never leave us. So praise be to you who has put your word into the hearts and lives of these people, and help us as a camp this summer to find what we need, but to do it in a way that honors you, that our hearts would be faithful to seek you through all things. Just pray this in your name, Lord. Amen. Oh, that was weird.
Please like stand ninjas. With us for your closing song. Sing God of love.
God of love, God of all glory, every day see new mercy. Great is your faithfulness. God of love, God of my story, never fail, never forsake me. Great is your faithfulness. I see you in the morning light, feel you in the fire by night. Hear you say, child, I am with you. Everything will be alright. See you in the tears that run. Feel you when the healing comes. I hear you say, beloved.
loving one, I am with you. Every moment of my life, I see you. I see you. I see you. God, I see you. God of love, God of new vision, every blessing you have given. Great is your faithfulness. Oh, how great is your faithfulness. I see you in the morning light, feel you in the fire by night, hear you say, child, I am with you, everything will be alright. See you in the tears that run, feel you when the healing comes. Beloved one, I am with you. Every moment of my life, I see you. I see you. I see you. God, I see you. I will worship through the storm, through the storm, through the storm. All my hope is in you, Lord, in you, Lord, in you, Lord. Through the storm, through the storm, all my hope is in you, Lord, in you, Lord. See you in the morning light, feel you in the fire by night, hear you say, child, I am with you, everything will be alright. See you in the morning light, feel you in the fire by night, child, I am with you, everything will be alright. See you in the tears that run, feel you when the healing comes. Hear you say, beloved one, I am with you, every moment of my life. I see you, I see you.
I'll keep talking. There you go. I hope you've been encouraged and inspired and trust that you will go in God's grace and peace. And I would invite you to take some time to in the lobby to meet the crew from Nest Lake, to see Mike and Richie and their families who are serving at the Family Work Week coming up here. And so we just love what God is doing, and we want to continue to partner with him. So go in God's strength today. Thank you so much for joining us both online and in person today. God bless you.